When we say priority scheduling, all the processes that we are given will be associated with certain priority, and we will have to take that into consideration while we find out the average waiting time and average turnaround time. Can we have numericals, please? Okay.
Processes.
I'm going to draw the table, right? Processes.
P1, P2, P3, P4.
P1, P2, P3 and
P4.
P4, yeah. And then?
Burst time.
CPU burst time.
8, 5.
8,
5,
5,
4,
4,
3.
3, okay. See, in priority scheduling, like SJF, you'll have two possibilities. Either primitive or non-primitive. Whenever you are given the arrival times in the table, that means most probably you will be using primitive version of the priority scheduling. If the arrival times are not given, that means you will be using non-primitive version of the priority scheduling. So first let us solve the non-primitive version, which means we will not have the arrival times.
Priority.
Okay. So just priority.
Two, one, three, four.
Here the priorities are also given. The convention for priority is the lower the number of priority, lower the number means highest priority. Which means one here, that means P2 is having the highest priority. The lower the number, higher the priority. So one, P2 is having highest priority, followed by P1, then P3, then P4. Alright, once we have the data, now we must calculate the average turnaround time and average waiting time. But before we do all that, we must draw Gantt chart. So I'm gonna dedicate this space towards drawing the Gantt chart. And you also have to maintain the queue.
Right.
First thing first, arrival times are not given. That means all the processes have arrived at the same time. You'll have to assume that. Now, out of all the processes that have arrived at the same time, we'll have to arrange them according to their priority. Now, as we discussed earlier, the highest priority is with P2. So, P2 gets into the queue first, followed by P1, then P3, and then P4. So, as they go into the queue, they get the CPU. So, first P2 gets it. How much is the requirement of P2? 5. So from 0 to 5, CPU is occupied by P2. Then P1, how much is the requirement of P1? 8. So 5 to 13, we have P1. After that P3, how much is the requirement of P3? 4. From 13 to 17, occupied by P3. And then P4, how much is the requirement of P4? 3. So final 3 are for P4. See, this order is like highest priority to lowest priority. This is our Gantt chart. T equal to 0, right? Now, let's calculate the turnaround time and waiting time for each process. So process, waiting time and turnaround time. Process P1. What is the waiting time for P1? From the diagram, waiting time is 5. This much is time. And what is the turnaround time? 5 plus
6.
CPU burst time 8. That is 13. P2, waiting time. Waiting time for P2 is
0.
P2 began almost immediately, right? The waiting time for P2 is 0. Turnaround time is 0 plus 5. 5. P3, waiting time is 13, if I may say. Waiting time is 13. Turnaround time is 13 plus 4, 17. And P4, waiting time is 17. Turnaround time is 17 plus 3, 20. What is the total of turnaround time? 55. Total of waiting time? 35. Total of waiting time is 35, total of turnaround time is 55. Average waiting time equal to total waiting time divided by number of process of 4. So 8.75. Average turnaround time equal to total turnaround time, that is 55. Delta 4?
13.75.
So this is your average waiting time and average turnaround time.